So good morning everyone. I welcome you all in the new session of hydrology. We have started with the second unit, that is your evaporation and transpiration. We have started with the introductory part of evaporation. What are the various factors which causes evaporation? What are the various factor which can affect evaporation? And we have also studied about some of the instrument with the help of which we can measure evaporation. We have seen about basically two instrument, three methods. The first method is by using an instrument which is called as evaporimeter. This can be used to measure evaporation. The second one was your empirical equation. There are various empirical equation available so that we can use this equation and directly calculate the evaporation. And the third one is your analytical method. These two equation, the first one and the second one, these two method we have already seen in a previous class. Let me revise you what was that. The first instrument, evaporimeter, basically it consists of some metallic pans. This type of pan you can see, then the water has been stored in this pan and it is kept for some interval, and how much of water get depleted or how much water can evaporated that particular times, that particular level has been noted. By this can represent, or this, by this you can get the value of evaporation. Okay, so we have various type of instruments available. The first instrument which is available is USWB Class A evaporation pan. Okay, the description about this I've already told, explained in the previous class. The diagram is over here. If you have not seen my previous video, please try to see the previous video. You'll understand easily. Okay, then the second one is your ISI standard pan. Okay, the diagram for this is given over here. Okay, this is the ISI standard pan. Then there is your Colorado sunken pan. The Colorado sunken pan is basically half installed in soil. Okay, half installed in soil. Okay, so that it give a two representation of that particular reservoir. Okay, then after that there is USG floating pan, which generally floats on the rivers or the lake, of which you need to find out the evaporation. Okay, there are various drawbacks of evaporation pan because they do not truly represent the reservoir or the lake or the particular catchment area. So there are some drawbacks of evaporation pan. This we have discussed in the previous class. And then we have also studied about the pan coefficient, that we have different pan coefficients available for the different type of pans available. 0.7 for Class A pan, ISI pan is 0.8, sunken pan is 0.78, USGC floating pan is 0.8. These values are very important because these value, based on this we can calculate the lake evaporation, because the formula for lake evaporation is pan coefficient and pan evaporation. So we need, if you want to find out the lake evaporation, we need to multiply the pan coefficient. So based on the category of the pan available, we will choose the pan coefficient and then multiply by the pan evaporation. Okay, after that we have also studied about the empirical equation. We have various scientists have done various research on evaporation and they have come out with some equation so that we can calculate the evaporation. The first one is by Dalton type of equations. Okay, the first equation is EL into KF into U into EW minus EA. This I have discussed earlier. These are the various terms and what they represent. It is given over there. Then the second equation is given by the scientist Mayer. Okay, so the Mayer's formula, and then there is Rover's formula. Okay, then based on wind velocity we have also got one formula. Okay, after that we will come with the, we'll start with the new part, that is your analytical method of evaporation and estimation. This we have not seen in the previous class. We will try to do it in this class. Okay, now the first method, basically in analytical method we have three category, that is your water budget method, second is your energy budget method, and third is your mass transfer method. Okay, we will discuss each one by one. Okay, start with the water budget method. Basically it is, if the unit of time is kept very large, it says that if you want to study evaporation, if we keep the unit of that particular duration for a very large time, okay, so we'll get the better and accurate result for that. Okay, estimation of evaporation will be more accurate. It says that if the unit time is kept very large, estimation of evaporation will be more accurate. It is the simplest of all the method, but the least reliable. It says that it is the simplest among all among these three, and it is least reliable. That means it is not that accurate. Okay, the first part is saying that we must keep the duration for a larger duration so that we can get a better result. So the duration is generally keep in weeks, or sometime it is taken in months. So the water budget method, we have got this equation P plus VIS plus VIG equals to VOS plus VOG plus EL plus del S plus TL. So P represent what are the daily precipitation happening over there. Okay, VIS represent the daily surface inflow into the lake, so that is represented by VIS. VIG represent daily groundwater inflow. Okay, VOS daily surface outflow from the lake, whatever the water has been taken out from the lake, that is given. And then the daily groundwater flow. Okay, after that EL is equals to daily lake evaporation. Delta S means increase in lake storage in a day. TL equals to what? Daily transpiration loss. All the quantities are expressed in units of volume or depth. These all quantities are expressed in the units of volumes or depth, so that we can get the value for evaporation. Okay, so if you want to find out water budget method, we can use this equation. We need to collect all this data, and from this we can easily calculate the daily lake evaporation. Okay, after that there is energy budget method. So it involves basically the law of conservation of energy. It basically works on the principle of conservation of energy. Energy available for evaporation is determined by considering the incoming energy, outgoing energy, and the energy stored in the water body over a known period of time. So these three factors are very important to calculate your evaporation. We need to find out the incoming energy, we need to find out the outgoing energy, as well as the energy stored in the water body at various time interval. So for calculating evaporation, these three things are required: incoming energy, outgoing energy, and whatever the energy is stored in the body at a certain period of time interval. After that, there is estimation of evaporation from lake by this method has been found very satisfactory result with the error of order of 5% when applied to the period less than a week. So it says that this method is very, very much accurate, and it gives very satisfactory result. Okay. It gives an error about almost about 5% when it is applied to a period for less than 2 weeks. So that means it is a very good method and can be used effectively. So the equation which is available for your energy budget method is HN equals to HA plus HE. This is HB plus HG plus HS plus HI. So what does HN represent? HN represents the net heat energy received by the water surface. So that is represented by what? HN. So whatever the heat energy is received by the water body, it is represented by HN. HB represent back radiation from the water body. Some radiation gets reflected. So that energy is called as represented by HB. And then HA is represented by sensible heat transfer. Okay. So whatever the sensible heat transfer from the water surface to air, that is represented by HA. So whatever heat has been transferred from water surface to air, that is represented by HA. HG is mean heat flux into the ground. Whatever the heat gets inside the ground, that is represented by HG. HS mean heat stored in the water body. So whatever heat has been stored in the water body, that is represented by HS. HE represent heat energy used in evaporation. So whatever energy gets used for evaporation, that is HE. And HI is the net heat conducted out of the system of water flow. So these are all the terms. So by this you can easily calculate what your evaporation. Okay, so we'll get the value of HN from here. And this is the diagram of that. As you can see, some solar radiations are being absorbed, that is heat store, that is represented by HS. Some get stored into the ground, that is heat flux, that is HG. Okay, some advections happens that is represented by HI, evaporation, heat gets HA, heat loss to air is HA. Evaporation, heat involved in evaporation is HE, okay, this is HE. Some of them gets, some of the radiation gets back, that is represented by HB, okay, and HE is used solar radiation, okay. So these are all the different parameters which is being used to determine your evaporation by energy budget method, okay. Now energy balance in water body, this is the energy balance in a period of 1 day. All the energy terms are in calories square mm per day. If the time periods are short, HI and HS and HN can be neglected, they are negligibly small. All the terms except HA can be either measured or evaluated indirectly. HA is estimated by using Bowen ratios. So this is all about your energy balance method, okay, or you can say that it is also called as your mass transfer method. Now we will compare all the methods, okay. So analytical methods can provide good results, however they involve parameters that are difficult to assess. So it is very difficult sometimes to measure what is the heat stored in the water lake, what is the heat going to be stored in the water body. So it is very difficult to measure that. So analytical method can provide a good result, but it is sometimes difficult to assess the various data. After that, so this is the first point of analytical method. Basically, it's saying that though analytical methods provides very good result, but sometimes to find out the various parameters, it becomes difficult to assess. Okay, the second one is your empirical method, empirical equations. Empirical equations can be the best, give approximate value for the correct order of magnitude. So it is better to say that in order to get an approximate value, you can use empirical equation for that. But most of the time in the actual practice, you can see that pan measurements find wide acceptance in practice. Mostly the pan measurements are generally used all over the world to find out the evaporation process or to measure the evaporation. So, and this is all about your comparison analytical method. Though they are accurate, but they are not used because of the various parameters required. Second, empirical equations can be used to get approximate result. And the third one, which has been most widely used all over the world, is your pan measurement. And this pan measurements has been accepted by all over the world. Okay. After that, what are the methods to reduce evaporation? There are various methods by which you can reduce the evaporation. Okay. The annual evaporation from water bodies in Pakistan can range from 1 to 2 meters. So you can see that it is clearly saying that in an year, about 1 to 2 meter of water gets evaporated. So such a loss of water is, and there is such a loss of water because of evaporation. The bigger the surface, more is the evaporation. Obviously, the more the surface area, more will cause its evaporation. So it can be reduced by the following evaporation. One of the method to reduce evaporation is by reducing the surface area of the reservoir. So we need to restrict the area of reservoir. What will happen because of this, there will be less surface area available, that will reduce the evaporation, okay. After that, windbreakers should be applied in the form of trees that should be planted near the rivers or the lake, okay. So what will happen because of these trees, there will be at some, the winds will not be able to reach the lake and the reservoir very easily, and it will ultimately reduce some of the evaporation, okay. Sometimes mechanical covers are also used, artificial covers are laid over the rivers or lakes or the ponds, so that it does not expose to sunlight and it reduces the evaporation. This is effective, but it is a very expensive method because sometimes the catchment area is so big that it is very costly to use or to cover that ocean, okay. Then there is monomolecular films. A thin film of chemical is spread, which reduces the evaporation. Sometimes some chemicals are added into the water that reduces somewhat evaporation. Okay, so these are the four methods which can reduce evaporation to some extent. okay, reduction of surface area. Surface area should be reduced so that there should be less evaporation, because more the surface area, more will be the evaporation. Less the surface area, less will be the evaporation. Windbreakers, one of the main reason of evaporation is because of the wind. So if we plant more trees near the wind, near your lakes or your water bodies, what will happen? It will restrict the wind to some extent, and because of it, the evaporation will be less. Okay. After that, mechanical cover. Sometimes some mechanical covers are also used to cover the water bodies so that they are directly not so that they are not being exposed to sunlight directly, and that also somewhat reduces evaporation. But sometimes the catchment area is so big, it becomes very expensive to use this type of method. Then there is monomolecular film. Sometimes some chemicals has been added on the water body so that they reduces evaporation to some extent. Okay, this is all about your evaporation. After that, we will see the next part of this topic, that is your transpiration. Okay, so transpiration basically is the process of water being taken into an evaporating from plant. Basically, what happens, transpiration, you can say that while the precipitation comes to the ground, some part of your precipitation is been absorbed by the plant, so they remains in the plant, and after its consumption by the plant, some water gets evaporated from its leaves. That process is nothing but your transpiration. That process is called as your transpiration, evaporating from plants. Okay, now evapotranspiration means what? Basically, it involves both the process, that is evaporation and transpiration. Okay, so it is a term used to describe the sum of evaporation and plant transpiration. So evaporation is happening as well as it is happening from plants, then together when they are added, they are called as evapotranspiration. So evaporation is happening from where the lakes and the water bodies, and some water gets evaporated from the plant, they are called as transpiration, and together they are called as evapotranspiration. Okay, now evaporation accounts for the movement of water to the air from the source such as soil. So evaporation basically involves the loss of water or the movement of water from to the air from various sources like soil, canopy interception, and the water bodies. Transpirations, so evaporation basically happens from these three places, that is your soil, canopy interception. Sometimes water gets stored into the various rocks while flowing, so that water gets evaporated, and the water bodies, the evaporation also happens from water bodies. So these are the main source of your evaporation. Transpiration happens from where transpiration accounts to the movement of water within the plant and subsequent loss of water as vapor through the stomata in the leaf. So basically what happens, the water, the precipitation, when it reaches the ground, they are sometimes absorbed by the plant, and they, as you know that water, plant consumes water, so some movements of water happens into the plant, and with the help of the various route, they ultimately reaches the stomata into the leaves, and from where it gets evaporated, where it comes in contact with the solar energy and gets evaporated, and that process is nothing but a transpiration. So the main source of your transpiration is basically your plants. So evapotranspiration is important part of the water cycle. So as I have told you in the water cycle in your first unit, that water cycle consists, one of the main processes is your evapotranspiration. Okay. Then evaporation and transpiration occur simultaneously. So basically evaporation and transpiration are both happens simultaneously. So it is no easy way to distinguish between the two processes. So they are considered to be a singular part, and that's why it has been given as the name as evapotranspiration. Okay. As you can see over here, there is a diagram showing over here. Some water gets evaporated from here. Some water gets evaporated from the small trees or the small plants, baby plants, and some water gets evaporated from the trees. Together they cause what? Evaporation plus transpiration, they are together called as evapotranspiration. Okay. Now, what are the various methods by which you can estimate the evapotranspiration? There are three methods. One is your catchment water balance, one is your hydrometeorological equation, and one is your energy balance. So we will see one by one each. So first we'll start with the catchment water balance. So evapotranspiration, What does catchment water balance say? Is that evapotranspiration may be estimated by creating an equation. So by creating an equation of water balance of drainage basin. So if we consider a drainage basin and we can consider or we can find out an equation for water balance, we can use the water balance equation to find out evapotranspiration. The equation balances the change in water stored within the basin. So the change in the basin stored has been represented by S with inputs and exports. So we need to consider what are the inputs and what are the exports. So first the input is precipitation. Obviously the input will be in the form of precipitation, that is represented by P, and the exports are evapotranspiration. The losses are in the form of exports, which is to be estimated. So evapotranspiration comes into exports, stream flow, whatever the water gets flows through stream, that is given by Q. The groundwater recharge, that is D. Okay, if the changes in the storage, precipitation, stream flow and the groundwater are all estimated, the missing flux ET or the evapotranspiration can be estimated by rearranging the above equation. So if we have got all this data, if we know the precipitation value, if we know the change in storage value, if we know the input, your stream flow value, we know the groundwater recharge value, we can easily calculate what evapotranspiration by using this equation. Okay, so that is your catchment water balance. So then there is hydrometeorological equation. So basically it is also an empirical equation which has been given by Blaney Criddle equation. This was the scientist who invented this equation. It is a purely empirical equation developed based on the data of arid western US. So basically they have done their study in US, and based on their studies they have come out with a formula. Assume the PET is related to the assume that PET is related to the hours of sunshine and temperature. PET is in a crop growing season. Basically this is the equation where K is an empirical coefficient that depends upon the crop of that month and the locality. F is the sum of monthly consumptive use factors for the period, which can be calculated by summation of pH by T bar F into 100. pH is the monthly percentage of annual daytime hour, and TF is your mean monthly temperature. Based on this, they have calculated what evapotranspiration. There is also a Penniman equation. I don't think this is that much important. After that, the third method is your energy balance method. So a third method, methodological to estimate the actual evaporation, is by using energy balance equation. So in this, an energy balance equation has been used where lambda E is the energy needed to change the phase of water from liquid to gas. So whatever energy is required to change the form of precipitation or the form of water from liquid to gas, that is given by lambda E. R is the net radiation. R is representing the net radiation. Okay, G is the soil heat flux. G represent whatever the heat has been stored inside the soil. And H is the sensible heat flux. So H is the sensible heat flux. If we have got all these values, we can calculate what your lambda E. Okay, based on this, using instrument like intertometer, soil heat flux plates, or the radiation meters, the component of energy balance can be calculated, and the energy available for actual evaporation can be solved. So whatever the energy available, we can easily calculate by using this equation. Okay, and these various parameters can be find out by this instrument which is called as intertometer. So you need to remember this name. So if you need to calculate what the soil heat, or sometime if you need to find out what the soil heat flux or the sensible heat flux, you need to require an instrument which is called as intertometer. So this is all about your energy balance equation. So these are the three methods which is basically used to find out what evapotranspiration. One is your catchment water balance, hydrometeorological equations, and your energy balance. Okay, and evapotranspiration is also being measured with an instrument which is also called as lessimeter. Sometimes this instrument is also used to find out what your this one for finding out your evapotranspiration. We can also use an instrument which is also called as lessimeter. So this is all about your evapotranspiration. Okay, now we have left with a small numerical related to evaporation. We'll see in that in your next class. Okay, thank you.